Thank you. Thank you. So are we on? You can hear? Okay, great. Good morning, and I have the distinct privilege of finally getting to meet a hero of mine, Libby Chamberlain. Libby grew up in Maine and Illinois and North Carolina and one other place,
Massachusetts.
And is settled now in Brooklyn, Maine after coming to Maine to work at Shewanki. She was a college counselor at GSA, George Stevens Academy, until one day in October of 2016, she started this sweet little Facebook page to get, you know, just a few of her friends to wear a pantsuit to the polls to vote for Hillary in what was sure to be a victory for the first U.S. president, female president of the United States. So I just want a show of hands. Has anybody not heard of Pantsuit Nation before you read the blurb? Okay, we need to do the founding story. Okay, Libby, so what is Pantsuit Nation and how did it start and why?
Sure. So, hi everyone. Can you hear me okay? Great. Well, I'm really excited to be here. Just first of all, want to say thank you all so much for coming. And as Lynn mentioned, I live, as a crow flies, not so far in Brooklyn, Maine, as the car drives a little bit longer. I can actually see MBI from my house, but can't get there from here. But and I often am sort of sitting behind my computer screen and working so much in a digital space and communicating with people all over the country that I actually don't get to talk about my work that much in person with people. So this is really a huge pleasure for me. So thank you for having me, the College of Atlantic, and for Lynn for the introduction. So yeah, let's talk a little bit about how Pantsuit Nation got started. And Lynn kind of nailed it. I mean, I was working part-time at both D.R.L. Stonington High School and George Stevens Academy. I'd just gone back to work. I had a one-year-old and a three-year-old. I was still breastfeeding. And I was really passionate about Secretary Clinton's candidacy and everything that her candidacy represented for women, for all marginalized people in this country, and especially what she sort of represented in the face of her opponent and sort of standing for the values that I kind of held dear and saw as the future of our country. And I didn't hear that a lot. I didn't hear a lot of enthusiasm about Secretary Clinton. I heard a lot of like meh kind of things. And that didn't represent my feelings about her as a candidate. And it didn't actually represent a lot of my friends and their feelings about her as a candidate. But that sort of seemed to be the popular kind of media projection of who she was. And I felt whenever I went online, you know, I live in a rural area, I have two young kids, and so I talked about politics a lot on Facebook and kind of anytime I put an opinion out there about Secretary Clinton, it was often swiftly and sometimes pretty harshly put down by a lot of that same sort of negative energy and talking about her as a shill of the Democratic Party or whatever was being talked about at that point. So I felt like I didn't have a space to express my enthusiasm and genuine sort of belief in her as a candidate and her values anywhere online. And in person, that was tricky too. So the morning after the third debate, where she wore this like fabulous white pantsuit and she looked incredible, that was the debate. Now looking back, it's a little bit eerie where you know she was calling Trump a puppet, and he said, no, you're the puppet, and there was this whole thing about Russia, and now looking back, she was right. But the morning after that, it was this sort of, this feeling that I've been having over the last several months of feeling like she nailed it, feeling like she had spoken so eloquently and beautifully about the future that she envisioned for our country, and yet there was conversations about what she was wearing, and her voice, and her demeanor, and not about sort of the substance of her values and sort of her policy positions and the ways that she had really articulated her vision for our country. So I was chatting with a friend of mine and I said, you know, I want to show my support in a way that feels sort of emblematic of who she is as a candidate and the fact that she's the first woman nominee for a major party in our country. So I said, I'm going to wear a pantsuit to vote for her on election day. So this was like 3 weeks away at this point, so pretty close to the election. And I'm going to see if I can get some other people around the country to do the same thing. Because wouldn't it be cool if I saw on Instagram, like, a buddy of mine from California, like wearing a pantsuit to the polls and taking a selfie and something. And I was like, and I also want to give people an opportunity to get excited about this day and not feel like there's this dark cloud hanging over with emails and WikiLeaks and all of that. Like, this is a big deal, and let's celebrate it in the way that I think it should be celebrated. So I invited about 30 of my friends via Facebook to this secret group. And I made it secret because I didn't want that like automatic reflex of everyone coming in and sort of hating on Hillary, which was like the thing to do. I wanted this to be a place for people to have that moment of celebration and excitement without fear of being attacked, and women in particular, not being able to express their views online because they were sort of then quickly attacked. So I made it secret, invited about 30 friends, closed my computer, went back to work, and didn't really pay attention. And then about an hour later, there were like 1,500 people in this group already, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. I mean, and how cool that there are so many people that are so quickly kind of finding this space where they can, and people are posting things very quickly about like pantsuits, I love it, and I couldn't wear a pantsuit when I was a kid going to high school.
But say, so it's a secret group. So you invited 30, you had to be invited by somebody who was a member. So the fact that it went from 24, I think, to 1,500 in
an hour, 2 hours. And yeah, so people were inviting their friends in, like, finally, we've got a place where, like, no one's going to yell at us for supporting Secretary Clinton. And so then I was, like, I was very excited at that moment, and I was, like, this is going to be amazing, like, there's a possibility that a stranger that I don't know personally is going to wear a pantsuit to the polls on election day, and like, my job here is done. Like, this is awesome. the next day, and so I kept watching the numbers kind of climb up, and my initial friends that I've been texting with about it, they were like, we were like, wow, it just keeps going. By the next day, about 24 hours in, we had 24,000 people in the group. And people were psyched, and that was really, really great to see, because again, I think for women in particular, there was this huge outpouring of talking about their excitement of voting with their mothers, with their daughters, intergenerational voting, talking like literally a lot of pantsuit talk, because the pantsuit is emblematic of women, you know, fighting for equal rights and equal sort of recognition in spaces. A lot of women who work in like lawyers and people in science talking about their fight to like literally be able to wear pants to work was a thing. And as like I'm a millennial, like it didn't actually occur to me how much the pantsuit would be an emblem to some women that were older than me about this kind of struggle for equality. And Facebook like promptly shut us down because they thought we were robots because it was like growing so quickly. They didn't shut us down, but they made it so we couldn't add more people. So, you know, I'm already going back and forth, and I'm like tweeting at Sheryl Sandberg and Mark Zuckerberg being like, open us back up again. We're so excited. finally, they it's called whitelisting, basically. They said, okay, you're a real person. These appear to all be real humans that just really love Hillary. Like, let's let them do their thing. and then it was just like, I mean, the growth was exponential. We had 100,000 within probably 6 days after that. We got to 1 million on November 1st, and so that was less than 2 weeks after starting the group. And so I'm quickly trying to bring in some help, right? So I'm like with my little internet connection in Brooklyn, Maine, and I've got the two kids and the two part-time jobs, and my husband is like, what's happening right now? And I was like, I don't even know. I can't form sentences, but there's a lot of people here and a lot going on. We very, very quickly in the beginning, I made some decisions about the kind of content that we were going to uplift within the community, and that's been really important to us ever since. And that was basically original content. That's kind of the most easy way of understanding it. This wasn't going to be another place to share all of the same memes and articles and sort of tweets that other people were just, you know, flying around the internet. This is going to be a place for people to speak from their own personal experience about this moment. And some of that was very lighthearted. Some of it was a lot of pantsuits. It was a lot of, you know, taking pictures of voting with their families or early voting or talking about volunteering. And some of it was really heart-wrenching and talking about sort of what Hillary's opponent at that time represented in the fear that people felt heading into this moment in our nation's history and what their vote represented in terms of their ability to live full lives and love who they want to love and live where they want to live and all of that. So a huge balance, but really focusing on that original content.
And were you at this point monitoring every, like, or could people just post whatever they wanted to post?
So very quickly we had to switch from sort of open posting to a post approval process, because with even 20,000 people all wanting to post the same, like, meme that they've seen about Hillary or about women or whatever it is, like, there was just so much repetition. So within the first few days, we switched to a post-approval process, and that means that we needed a team of people to go through all of the incoming content and decide which ones we were going to approve to the community. And also, like, moderating the comments and making sure there weren't trolls coming in and saying sort of hurtful or hateful things. So I had a bunch of volunteers, and within that same stretch, so between October 21st and November 8th, we brought in 190 volunteer moderators all over the world, who were, you know, working 24/7, helping with, yeah, looking at comments, making sure that the community was safe, or as safe as can be with that number of people, and also making sure that the content reflected our values, in terms of coming from personal experience. We didn't want it to be about attacking any of Trump's opponents or supporters, and making it feel like this was a place of support, celebration, and work. Like, we organized a phone bank the weekend before the election that was ranked in the top 10 in the country that weekend. We organized a small dollar fundraising campaign the weekend before the election that raised $220,000 for Secretary Clinton in just days before the election. We were helping people find resources for text banking and driving people to the polls and all this get out the vote stuff. We held gatherings all around the country in the day before and the day of the election. There's one in Blue Hill, where professional photographers had volunteered to take photos of people in their pantsuits voting for the first woman president. So this was all, like, a lot of stuff going on.
days before. I mean, it started in October 2016 and ramped up into this major activist thing in less than a month. Your head must have been spinning.
It was, and when I say I couldn't form sentences to my husband, because he was just like, what is going on, and like, can I help you? And I was like, can you delete memes from Facebook for me for about an hour? And he's like, okay, I can do that. Like, it was so hard, and I studied humanities in college. I had been working in you know, high school admissions. I had been working as a college counselor. I had, like, zero political background, no connection to Secretary Clinton's campaign. Didn't really, you've got a...
It's a little squirrel. There we go. Yeah.
He's out.
Yeah. We're free, and we have no judgment, and we just let all sorts of little farmland animals, woodland animals in. Very interesting talk. Everybody wants to come.
And we went from 2 million to 3 million members on Election Day alone, so it's like this exponential growth is just continuing. And I also had a lot of press coverage and interest, and so I was, like, doing... Like, NBC News is calling me and New York Times, and I did the first major media pieces with Wall Street Journal, of all places, but they had sort of found out about this phenomenon. So that was all happening, and it was all leading to this moment of, you know, Secretary Clinton would be elected and we would celebrate, and then we would, you know, I wasn't thinking that Pantsuit Nation would just end at that point. It was more like, how can we mobilize this incredible force of people that believe in her vision and her values to support her through what was sure to be a lot of obstruction from, you know, the GOP in Congress or whatever. So how could we sort of support her agenda when she became president? And I was already sort of thinking along those lines, but also just, like, total side gig kind of thing. Like, we'll just keep doing this somehow. And then after the election, I mean, you know, there was this moment, many moments, of grief and anger and confusion, and, like, I was just completely, like, whiplash almost. I was devastated, but I was also so surprised, and so it was hard to kind of look around at the country at that point and feel connected to people. And I think that Pantsuit Nation became that place of connection for many people after the election, feeling like they needed to see like the goodness in other people around them, and they needed to see that they weren't alone. A lot of our members are in the, you know, blue dots in very red parts of the country, and sometimes blue dots within their own families and within their own communities, and not feeling like they have that in-person network of people who shared their values that they could be in community with. And so they went online to find that. And Pantsuit Nation, I know, became a refuge for a lot of people, and especially right in the days after the election, to come together and feel like this is really bad. But I'm not the only one that feels like it's really bad, and there has to be sort of a next step.
Some of the stories were remarkably poignant. I think the secretness of the group, and it's hard to say a group is secret when it has 4 million members, but the fact that you could go, I mean, there were same-sex couples with their children saying, we have been rejected by our families, we live in the Deep South, this community means the world to me. There were black families in fear for, you know, what would happen to them under a Trump presidency. Just beautiful, heartrending. I'm the only one in my family. Thanksgiving's coming. I voted for Hillary. The stories were, they gave you so much hope, but you could also see the sort of quiet desperation of people who were unlike people in their family or community. So those blue dots in red states were some of the most, I think, poignant stories. So Hillary, I mean, people who were out there working for her said it was sort of like, where were you when the votes came in? It has the same searing national moment as, you know, the Twin Towers for some people, like, how could this happen to our democracy? My husband and I were actually in the south of France. We were on a long trek, and I was so excited. The world was so excited. We're just poised to have the first U.S. female president, and it's 8 hours ahead there, so we had to wait a very long time for the votes to come in. So I told Tim, we actually came out of the mountains to get a hotel room where there was a TV so we could watch and be part of the celebration. I said to him, wake me up at 2 a.m. And I wake up and there's light coming through the window. And I said, why didn't you wake me? And he said, the story's not good. And I'm like, what do you mean? Like, I thought this squirrel got up here. How could that be? I mean, all the polls, everything had prepared us for like confetti and balloons, and so we're walking through town to get back out, and every TV and every little cafe was, and there were tears streaming down French people's, like no one could believe it. And we were all just sort of shocked. So here it is. And how do you know what to do with this mobilized, passionate force? Like, now what? How did you make the decision to pivot or the next steps?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I could say there was a moment that was like, okay, like we're gonna be a thing and we're gonna be a nonprofit and we're gonna be a movement. I think it just felt to all of us, both within the community and those of us behind the scenes that were trying to sort of shepherd and lead this community, that there wasn't any choice. Like, we couldn't just like walk away from literally millions of people at that moment that needed and were craving and also showing their eagerness to participate in what comes next, which is you fight back and you don't sort of accept this you know, declaration of who we are as a country based on a vote. We say, you know, these are the values that we hold even more passionately now, and that we're going to do a better job as citizens and as people who care about one another. We're going to do a better job of creating the country that we want and that we see, and not just sort of sitting back and letting, you know, local politics all the way through the president of the United States sort of dictating what we are and who we are. We're going to participate more, and we saw that immediately. I mean, the Women's March started as a post in Pantsuit Nation on November 9th, and we had,
wow,
you know, people posting on November 9th. So in that day, we need a march. We need women showing up in Washington, D.C., and people saying, yes, I'll be there, and I'll be there. And then it, you know, it went in and obviously became its own thing, but there was that energy immediately. There was also a lot of anger, and there was a lot and there continues to be an incredible amount of working through how white people in particular in this country had not really understood the implications of white supremacy and sort of the pervasiveness of it. And how that led to the election of Donald Trump, and that, you know, white supremacists didn't just like pop back up out of nowhere when he was elected. That sort of culture had been existing and developing alongside a lot of obliviousness on the part of white liberals. And so in Pantsuit Nation, we struggled through that as a community, especially early on, and we continue to do that now. And a lot of what we were doing immediately after the election was providing some resources to our community members and to white women in particular, saying this is how we're all participating in a set of expectations and privileges and standards that are making it easy for us to ignore what's been going on all along for people of color in our country. It wasn't all just like, let's join together and go and be the resistance. There was a lot of sort of internal reconciling of, you know, there isn't an equal sort of playing field even in those who oppose what our current president represents. And so that was an important piece of what we did in the beginning, and what we continue to do is provide a lot of educational resources for our community, many of whom are new to activism, to political engagement, but also to social justice sort of frameworks and understanding, you know, how the racial sort of the structures of racism in our country continue to lead to things like the election of Donald Trump, and how a lot of people just thought that, you know, we had President Obama and now we're
post
clear.
Yeah.
which obviously isn't true, but I think there's been so many different phases of acknowledging kind of all of our roles in upholding the standards of white supremacy that led to the election of Donald Trump, and then what we can do to change that, and to do that in, you know, following the lead of people of color who have been sort of saying this for much longer than the last 2 years.
So you say that Pantsuit Nation has three missions, is that right?
We have three sort of modes of operation. And the first is the one that I just talked about, and that's basically using personal narrative and storytelling, and our goal is to amplify the voices and experience of people at the margins of power, so people who historically don't get the mic in our country, who aren't, you know, given an opportunity to have their stories shared with millions of people. So we focus on hearing from people of color, people from the LGBTQIA community, from immigrants, from people from religious minorities, from people with disabilities, people who have chronic health issues, people who are low income or have less education, and lift those stories up in order to have everyone feel kind of connected and motivated to take action, and to take political action. So using personal narrative and storytelling from individuals to then connect, like, oh, like, I guess it does matter, even if I'm not personally impacted by, like, the healthcare fight, then I can understand from someone else's personal, you know, experience why it's important for me to take action on this and call my senator and say, you know, protect the ACA. My healthcare is fairly secure, but I can understand why it's important for someone else. Or, I mean, there's so many examples. So linking, you know, storytelling with activism and education. So saying, you know, this is why reverse racism doesn't exist, because, you know, here's a few examples of people telling stories, or here is an example of someone talking about an experience of discrimination and how microaggressions, where, you know, these little instances of racism, which are seem sort of accidental, actually kind of contribute to the greater kind of systemic racism in our country. So educating through personal stories as well, and we do that a lot. And choosing which stories to publish, often working with the writers, and then in the comments section, sort of working through the comments with people who might come in and say something that is coming from a place of less experience in working in social justice, and saying, well, you know, people really have a hard time with the idea of privilege, whether that's male privilege or white privilege or Christian privilege or, you know, heterosexual privilege, and people say, well, I'm not privileged, I've had to work really hard for what I've gotten in my life. And that's true, but that doesn't mean that, you know, there aren't structural sort of systemic privileges. And so we do a lot of education kind of through that. The second thing that we do is work with strategic partners. And so Pantsuit Nation, very early on, you know, we wanted to be our own nonprofit, to have sort of an entity that had a mission and goals and staff. But we also didn't want to replicate the work that other sort of legacy organizations like ACLU and Emily's List and Planned Parenthood and these other Move On organizations that have been around for a while. We didn't want to just repeat what they're doing, as well as some other new organizations that were coming up, like Swing Left and Indivisible and Sister District and Flippable and all these great new grassroots organizations that all had sort of a little piece of what was becoming a very powerful movement. So we do strategic partnerships with dozens of other organizations, basically to be the loudspeaker. What we do have is a lot of people who are very engaged in our community. We still have, on average, about 550,000 people a day who are interacting with content in our space, in our community. So we're sort of this like big megaphone that then kind of helps people who are interested in doing something, but they're maybe not sure what or how to take the first step. So we say, well, you know, if you want to volunteer to register voters, you know, here's an organization called Spread the Vote that's doing amazing work getting people voter IDs. Or I want to write postcards to potential voters. Okay, so here's Sister District, and they're working on flipping state legislatures. Or I want to run for office. Okay, here's Run for Something. If you're a millennial and you want to run for office, here's an organization that's exactly set up to do that. So we work with all of these different organizations to try and get our community members the resources to take action in a way that feels meaningful for them.
That's true.
Yes, I'm going to take a breath.
And just while Libby's taking a breath, the phenomenon has not eroded. If a post goes up, there could be thousands of comments on always hundreds of comments that just cascade down from a post. People are so engaged in this. It's a space that I don't know it's equal, really. I mean, it was such a powerful place for people to be. So now you can go and talk about your third.
Yes, so
mission.
Third is, it's 2018, we all know this, midterms are this year. So we also have electoral strategy. So we're working really hard to do some really tactical work to support this election year and support progressive candidates, support Democrats winning up and down the aisle. And so there's a few different ways that we're doing that this year. The first one is one of my favorites. It's just through candidate amplification and support. And so through our community, kind of up through our ranks, we've had hundreds of people, mostly women, say that they're going to run for office. And so that's everything from school board, I'm a local school board member, through Congress people and people running for governor. And so I work, it's usually me, I work with these candidates to have their campaigns craft a post for Pantsuit Nation and to get the word out about what office they're running for. And we do that for a couple of different reasons. We sort of believe in the reverse coattails effect, which is that term was invented by our friends, the founders of Run for Something, where they feel like if you can get excited about a local candidate,
and someone who's going to impact your community directly, and, you know, thinking about your crosswalks and your local school and town ordinances and the things that really impact your day-to-day life. And you can get excited about volunteering for them, getting out to vote for them, you know, showing up to vote for them. That can actually help increase turnout for all elections. And so rather than this idea of like you vote for the top of the ticket and like hopefully the people lower on the ticket get voted for too, because mostly you're focused on your senator's race or your presidential race, instead get excited about your local candidates. And that can help increase turnout. So we really try and focus on a lot of local races, and not just for the people in that community, but so people, it's like a civics lesson for these millions of people that are engaging in our community every day, where we say, like, if you want to see change, start at the local level and think about your local races, your state races. Looking back in 2017, like the Virginia House was flipped, right? And that was a huge victory for Democrats. And then we go back and we show, you all remember what happened in Virginia. You know, we got excited about this candidate. A lot of you guys volunteered and donated to them. Now look what they're doing in the state house this year. They're passing major, major laws that are changing sort of the lives of Virginians. And you can do that too in your own state. So we do a lot of candidate work, not just, again, to sort of focus on individual candidates in their communities, although we do some of that too, but to like get people excited about candidates sort of in general, and the idea of supporting exciting, new, passionate candidates up and down the ticket. So we do probably 3 to 5 of those a week, where we have someone coming in and posting about their race. We're also doing a Get Out the Vote campaign this year through Facebook Messenger, and so we've read all these studies that one of the best, probably the best way to increase voter turnout is to have a personal ask from a friend, someone that you know, saying, are you voting? What's your voting plan? Can I count on you to vote? And this is a nonpartisan thing from our perspective. So we, you know, everybody vote. Whoever you're voting for, just please vote. And so using Facebook Messenger, which is now the third largest social media platform in the world, it's like Facebook, Twitter, Facebook Messenger, like it's massive. Billions of people are just using Messenger. So trying to use that friend-to-friend contact to get people to hold their friends accountable for their votes and for voting plans, and trying to reach as many people as possible ahead of the election through that. And then we also work with some of our partner organizations are really focused on electoral strategy. So we're partners for Swing Left is holding a massive, it's called The Last Weekend, go to thelastweekend.org. We're partners for that, so you can sign up to volunteer the last weekend before midterms to canvass right in your own community. And that, you know, again, studies show that last weekend, right before the election, that's the most impactful time. If you're going to volunteer at all in the fall, do it over that weekend. Get out and talk to people and encourage them to vote. We also work with a really cool organization called Mobilize America, where basically candidates and campaigns and organizations can create remote volunteer opportunities. So, you know, I live in Kansas, but I really love, you know, this candidate that I heard about online who lives in Atlanta, and I want to help her. Turns out she's got a dashboard on Mobilize. I can call from my house in Kansas, and I can get lists and, you know, phone numbers and call scripts, and I can make phone calls across the country. And so we work with Mobilize to highlight a few candidates that we're the most excited about so people can volunteer from home.
So Pantsuit Nation is more than Facebook platform. You also have a podcast and you have a book.
Yes.
You want to talk some about those?
Yeah. So the book, so in, I meant to mention this earlier, but in her speech the day after the election, her concession speech, Secretary Clinton, like, not by name, but she basically mentioned Pantsuit Nation, and she said, for everyone that has been, you know, essentially behind closed doors and in these secret Facebook groups supporting me, I want you to come out from behind that. And this is my sort of request to you is to have your voices be louder and out there in the world a bit more. And so I, you know, personally took that to heart. I kind of, on behalf of the community and the organization that I was building, took that to heart and felt like, you know, what we've maintained, built and maintained in Pantsuit Nation on Facebook is important, but there are sort of public components to that that we really need to get out into the world. And so the book was the first one, and it was sort of a beautiful solution for me and for our leadership team in a lot of ways, because it was one important piece of that. It was taking a lot of the stories that you sort of referenced earlier mm-hmm. about kind of capturing this moment in our nation's history and putting them in a book for public consumption, and went through a very lengthy permissioning process to contact hundreds of contributors, ask if they wanted to have their stories published in a book, and having them sort of submit everything for the book. It also provided a source of revenue, so I was sort of like, you know, looking back on it, I was lucky to have like a few thousand dollars in savings, basically, so I could pay for email addresses and like get some extra childcare for my kids, and I hire a lawyer fairly quickly. A lot of kind of startup expenses where I was really, and I remain pretty hesitant to sort of ask people for money all the time in Pantsuit Nation. I didn't want to just like set up GoFundMes. So the book promised like at least a little bit of revenue kind of down the line so that I could have a seed fund for this nonprofit that we were already envisioning at that point. And then it also answered the request. I mean, so many people kept saying, like, this is so ephemeral. There's so much content. It comes and goes, and there's no way to, at that point, search in Facebook was really hard to go back and find anything. And people were saying, like, I keep reading these, and I can't save them, and it's just happening so quickly, and there's so much new stuff. I want something permanent and sort of preserved about so many of these beautiful stories. And I really felt that too, personally. And so that was sort of the community saying, we want something that exists beyond Facebook to share with our friends and family and to preserve. So the book did that. It happened very quickly, which was challenging. Like we announced the book in December, and it was published in May, which for anyone that's familiar with book publishing,
gosh, yeah.
for a full color, like, you know, fully prep, like, it, you know, it was a lot to do very quickly. And that was, you know, over a year ago. Around the same time, started talking about a podcast, because again, it was like, you know, these stories, it felt like they needed to have a larger audience. And sometimes it's hard to get all the textures and nuances and sort of depth of the story in a Facebook post, right? It's a very like specific medium that's usually photo plus text, and you don't always get a chance to really dig in and truly hear, like literally hear someone's voice. I'm going to adjust this. She's looking at me.
She's looking at you.
Yeah. Is that better? Yeah. So the podcast, we started talking about it almost immediately. We didn't launch it until just about a year ago. And that is co-hosted with, is me and Courtney, who's our executive director. And it's turned into an opportunity in some ways to hear stories from our community, but much more so to talk about people who are sort of movement leaders across a lot of different areas and ways of kind of contributing to the resistance, or whatever you want to call it. So we have, like, we've talked to Senator Gillibrand and Secretary Clinton, but we also talk to people who are chefs and, you know, comedians and authors and journalists. People who are founders of a lot of some of the organizations that I've mentioned, people who have changed careers after the election to focus and start new organizations, people that are sort of, what we try and do through the podcast is show that even if you don't like hear the word activist and like show up and say like, oh, that's me, even if you're not someone that goes out and protests on street corners, even if you don't want to run for office, each of us has the capacity and the potential to engage meaningfully in our world and in civics, and sort of to be a meaningful kind of agent of change in our own way. And that looks really different for everyone. And that's been part of our philosophy all along with Pantsuit Nation, is we're sort of activism type agnostic, I guess. Like we...
yeah.
It's not entirely true, because there are, like, we don't really believe in signing petitions. Like, that's not something that has been shown to have a tremendous effect. And so there are things where we sort of, we look at what what, you know, folks on the Hill say actually works in terms of direct kind of political engagement. But in terms of like what you're able to contribute, if you want to, you know, organize a house party for a candidate that you care about, or if you just want to send your $5 a month to someone that, you know, shares your values, or if you want to make phone calls, you know, you set your calendar reminder every week to make a phone call to your senator, and you have your list of things that you want them to hear, like, that's great. There's so many different ways to be engaged and to use your skill set to meaningfully affect change, and so that's sort of been the common thread both through Pantsuit Nation but also in the podcast.
Should we open it up? Is it time?
Yeah.
I can't really say. Yeah, yeah. Steffi?
Well, I think there's a common agreement that the 2016 election was a stolen election due to the many flaws in our democracy, primarily voter suppression, gerrymandering, and flipping the vote, as well as disinformation. There are still 5 states in the country, including mine, which is New Jersey, that have paperless voting machines. And so we have tried unsuccessfully to get paper ballots. The election is coming up, and now the only thing that we can do is encourage people to vote by mail, which we can do in New Jersey. Uh-huh. I'm wondering if your organization would take that on as a clarion call to all New Jerseyans, as well as people in Georgia, Mississippi,
Georgia,
Louisiana, and all of these other states where we know that there was hacking, and we know that there's going to be hacking, if they could vote by mail and have a paper ballot that can be recounted and audited, it would be much more secure. Is that something that your group could do?
Yeah, so we have kind of through our members, so the way that Pantsuit Nation operates is much of our content is user-generated, and so we still have a lot of our calls to action sort of come up through our members, and then we sort of decide which ones are best suited to our national community, and then we also have about 65 chapters, and so some of those are statewide chapters, some of them are regional, some of them are just city-based. And so we have heard this campaign, which is now, I think, gaining some steam around the mail-in ballot. And I think it's one of those things where we, like I mentioned earlier, our approach is sort of as the loudspeaker, as an informational resource. And so what we don't have is, you know, we only have 2 people that work full-time for Pantsuit Nation. So we don't have sort of the on-the-ground infrastructure to like really wage a campaign to accomplish something that's that specific. But what we can do is if someone submits a post and we sort of, it feels like a good call to action, is put that information out there. And we also try and direct our chapter leaders to those kinds of state-level initiatives, because often in the national group, that kind of content, based on, unfortunately, on Facebook algorithms, doesn't get as much sort of lift as something else that has sort of a national audience. And so getting it to the state level chapters and making sure that they have the information is the best way to kind of target and get people who can actually take action involved in that kind of initiative.
Another question? So I yeah, you got one? Yeah. Okay, good. Mr. Longsworth.
Hi.
Hi.
I was just wondering, you spoke a little bit about the core team that you assembled pretty early on, it sounds like, but you also said that you only had 2 people working full-time now for Pantsuit Nation. I wonder if you could just speak to how that team was developed, how you went around gathering those people, and, you know, if there's been diminishment or increase in that leadership team since. Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you. I love that question because it's one of the things that I'm the most proud of in terms of how we've kind of really truly as a grassroots organization come from sort of within. And as I mentioned, very early on, we had this huge surge of volunteers that were coming in at such a pace where I didn't actually have sort of individual personal connection with many of them. It was just like, you know, here's the overarching thing of what we're trying to do here. And as the weeks went on, and especially in the first few weeks after the election, there were a number of people that really rose to what I talked about earlier, which was some of the kind of balancing all of the different energies that were coming into that space in those weeks. And so understanding that there was already some hope and some fight, there's a lot of anger, there was a lot of like just sadness and desolation, and managing the nuances of those emotions and leading productive conversations in the midst of that really complicated, you know, several months. Leaders emerged very quickly within that in terms of my team, and it was people saying, you know, this is the kind of content that we need to be putting into the community at this point to lead productive conversations. It was working in those comment sections, educating members, and we have this sort of ethos in Pantsuit Nation, which again contributes, I think, to the continued success and engagement, which is we hold some pretty hard lines on things in terms of our values, but we try and educate our members with a lot of kindness and compassion and understanding that people are coming from a lot of different backgrounds and different levels of familiarity and comfort with activism and social justice. And so sort of educating with kindness and compassion is, it's hard to do online. And there were people within our, just our moderators, who really rose up to that very quickly. So we developed sort of a kind of all volunteers at this point. I mean, I wasn't paid, no one was being, there was no money for a really long time. And so we were all just volunteers, but working really closely together. And through that has come now our leadership team of 6 women. And we have about 15 or 20 volunteer kind of moderators beyond that. And except for one woman who we met through a Facebook event, actually, who moderated another community, all of them were from that initial group of moderators. So people who rose up, kind of volunteered in the beginning because they felt like this was a community that reflected their values and the kind of work that they wanted to do, and then just showed up day after day after day to sort of to be strong leading voices in the community. And so our executive director, Courtney, was just a volunteer. She sort of gradually took on more and more responsibility until I said, like, why don't you do this? Put your like very stable, you know, full-time job with lots of benefits and come work at this startup that who knows where it's gonna be in a couple of months. But thankfully she agreed. Similarly, we have so she and I are the only sort of full-time folks, and then we've got a director of engagement, director of community relations. We've got someone that does sort of more of our public facing. So we've got social media accounts on, you know, Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and our podcast, our newsletter and our website. So we have sort of these public facing parts of what we do beyond the Facebook group. And then we also have a chapter leader, like liaison, basically, who manages those chapters that I mentioned. So it all kind of came up from within the community. And these were, none of them were women that I knew before starting Pantsuit Nation. I met them all through this work.
I skipped over you because I skipped Gus before, so.
Our legal women voters in Pennsylvania has been looking at issues of how to improve the democratic process. And I just wonder, do members of Pantsuit Nation get involved in the League of Women Voters and their activities too?
So that's not an organization that we have established like a formal partnership with, but I can see us working with them because again, it's about sort of having educated, excited voters who are committed to showing up at every single election. And so much of what we try to do is that connection between, like, I think what unfortunately the GOP Republicans have done much more successfully than Democrats is connect personal values and kind of what we care about at home and within our own families and tight-knit communities with what happens kind of further afield with national politics. And I think that Republicans have become much more regular voters because they see that connection between the values that they hold dearly in their home and in the people most close to them with who they vote for at the state level, at the federal level. And so part of what Pantsuit Nation is doing and part of our theory of change is connecting what you care about in terms of who you love and who is important to you in your life and the health of your family and your children and their future and the environment, the things that really matter to you with your vote and trying to strengthen that connection in a way that has felt a little bit distant, I think, for the Democratic Party. And so that's a long-term, it's a very long kind of goal that we have, that it is sometimes challenging in the sort of episodic election cycles that we have to make that case, because we're talking about long-term narrative shifts in who we are as a party, what our values are, and why voting and sort of exercising your civic engagement muscles are connected. And it's not just like I go home and I, you know, have dinner with my family, or I go out and see my friends, and then voting is this thing that I do every once in a while because I have to. If they're all so linked that you can't think about not voting because it is so personal, right? Like, we want to make it so personal that it just becomes as natural as, you know, calling home at Thanksgiving. It's like you vote. So we try and support organizations that are providing resources to voters, but we're also focused on this like longer narrative of connecting personal life with civic engagement.
Hi. Sorry. Yeah. My wife can't be a voter because she's a legal immigrant, a green card holder, but probably won't be able, from Argentina, who probably won't be able to vote even in 2024 because of the slow process of these things. So for people who feel devastated by the results of an election that's out of their hands, so to speak. People like my wife, who unfortunately can't be here right now, but what sort of resources are you giving there? How, because she feels so disconnected from the process in that sense. I can go vote, but she can't.
Yep. Yeah, so that, it's so important, right? And there's so many disenfranchised, you know, people in our country that can't vote for a lot of different reasons, and our broken immigration process is a huge one, where, yes, taking action feels hard because you don't have that sort of fundamental, you know, stamp, essentially, of showing. But I think that, so there's a few different things. Civic engagement, you know, you can sort of think of as like a ladder, as a pyramid, or there's so many different, or like a highway, there's like a lot of off-ramps and ways to be engaged. And voting is a pretty fundamental one, but it's by no means the only one. And I think, like, even if you only focus on like the issue areas that you're passionate about, and you think about, you know, the environment is something that is really important to me, and so I'm gonna focus my advocacy and my activism around making sure that everyone in my community and, you know, the elected officials that represent me are, you know, that the environment is front and center. And so you can do that through your dollars, you can do that through showing up in person, you can do that through writing letters to the editor. I mean, there's so many ways to sort of have your voice heard in really powerful ways that don't necessarily come down to a vote. There's also just like the art of conversation, and disenfranchised voters, I think, it's a shame that they feel like their voice, their civic voice, has been taken away from them, because in some ways I think they have this amazing capacity to convince people to vote. So around the dinner table, mm-hmm. or at church or in community centers, there's an organization that we partner with called the Love Vote, and this is their whole mission, is they ask so teenagers, people that aren't of voting age yet, or immigrants, or formerly incarcerated people in areas where their votes have been taken from them. They get people to commit to vote on their behalf. They say, I care, you know, teenagers are a great example. If you're a 16-year-old right now in America, like, you've got a lot that you're thinking about and a lot that you're passionate about, and there's so much from school shootings and the environment to all of the legislation that's coming state by state in terms of, you know, barring transgender people from living full lives and equal lives and safe lives. There's so many issues that teenagers feel passionate about, and they can't vote either. And so getting people to talk and bring their community together and, yeah, over coffee or wherever it is, use their voice and say, I can't vote, and I desperately wish that I could vote because I care so much about this. I need everyone in my network to vote, because this is something that if you didn't have it, you would recognize sort of what the privilege that it is. So that sort of using your passion just to bring in people around you, like I said earlier, the most effective method of increasing voter turnout is to hear from someone that you care about and a friend that they want you to vote. So I think there's a lot of different levels, but I totally hear that that's a frustration, especially when immigrants, you know, regardless of status and documentation status, are among the most marginalized in our country right now. And so layer that with a feeling of not having as much capacity to change is a huge challenge.
Let's do one more.
Hi. So I was one of those early people who got the invitation to join Pantsuit Nation, and was like, wow, this is really cool. This speaks to me. And then through the grapevine, I found out the founder was from Maine. And I was like, that's even cooler because I live here. And then I realized, oh my God, she's across the bay. And so I just sort of had a lot of enthusiasm right from the get-go. So my question is maybe a little bit more personal than political, which is, you mentioned a minute ago that it's where the work that you do is towards, I think you said, a long-term change in narrative. Mm-hmm. But from everything I'm putting together, your life didn't take a long-term change. Your narrative changed like boom overnight.
Yeah.
So how do you navigate that in your personal life? I think that you really embody the old theory that one person can really make a difference on this planet. So I wanted to say thank you for all that work. How do you handle that on a personal level in terms of your job, your career, your family, what you love to do on the weekends? How does it all fit?
Yeah, well, thank you, and thank you for asking. It's I mean, it's one of those things that has felt like a calling to me since the beginning, in that like there have been moments when I looked at my husband being like, I can just stop. Like, I can walk away from this. This isn't something that I planned. This isn't something that I, you know, necessarily have the skill set for in this moment, although I'm building it as quickly as I can. But at the same time, those conversations very quickly for both of us led to, like, no, like, this is really important, and there are a lot of people who are coming together in this space, and so that has been at the back of my mind this whole time. It was really just about impossible to have any sort of balance or ability to separate for about a year. So about this time last year, it was like I couldn't sit down and watch TV with my husband. My moments were taking care of my children, you know, sleeping and working. And there was pretty close margins there. Like, I just didn't have a lot of space to exist as a person, and so it has been a transition, you know, in the last year. So since last summer, after the book was published and after some of the initial whiplash finished, is sort of finding a new kind of balance. This isn't the kind of work that ever stops, and the internet is always there, and there were months and months when I would wake up every day and there would be some, you know, explosion of drama that had happened overnight that would take, you know, half of a day to kind of resolve and clean up and figure out what was going on, and then we'd go about our day and then it would happen all over again. And that, thanks to our moderation team and sort of the way that they've established rapport and trust within the community, that doesn't happen as much anymore. So now I actually just got yesterday and the past weekend, I was on like a real vacation with my family, which I did not do for a really long time. In the summer, I've taken two like screen-free, Facebook-free vacations. So that was like a big step for me. And I think as a founder, and with Facebook, it's so funny because it's so tied into my own identity too. And like, I am my online identity, which I consider to be pretty close to my actual identity, grown up with it. You know, the community knows me and they've gotten to know me, and I had to create some separation at some point because I was just getting too many people kind of coming at me from a lot of different places, for lack of a better way to describe it. Having said that, like I mentioned, the team of women that I work with now and beyond that, probably another 100 or 200 people that I've met online now enrich my life immeasurably. So I have this huge network that I never could have imagined I would have had. I've gotten to meet you know, founders of incredible organizations and people that I sort of idolized and had these amazing conversations on our podcast and traveled and had opportunities to do things. So it's a balance of like my life is never going to be as, what, you know, honestly, after the 2016 election, I think anyone with a heart has felt like they can't ever relax again until we see some change. It's sort of like, okay, well, I can't just like, I can't just ignore what's happening anymore. It's not, that's a privilege that I didn't know that I had. And now I need to work hard. And I feel that for the sake of my children, for the sake of our country, it's like, I can't just sort of ignore the news and I can't kind of go back to that space, because that's part of what led to what happened, is just this sort of blissful, well, that doesn't impact me directly, so I can afford to not pay attention. So I think in some ways my like sort of near constant state of agitation is probably just like slightly more pronounced than I think what a lot of people in our country are feeling right now, which is anxiety, but also some hope and some feelings of, well, we can change things and we can do more. So that's a very long-winded and circuitous response. But
well, we're glad you're not walking away. Yeah, that's I'm reminded of, we had an artist last year, Roxana Geffen, who built on Ruth Bader Ginsburg's dissent collars, you know, and I'm reminded of the connection between the power of garb and dissent, or having your voices heard. So I wanted to thank Lynn and thank Libby for being here and give them a round of applause.
We have the book signing. Thank you.